Hi, I'm Dr. Robert Kaufmann, and we're about to go beyond the Terminus. Today, we're going to take a few extra minutes over the usual beyond the Terminus time to discuss the concept of endodontic recalls or follow-up appointments. Recent discussions of how we measure treatment success and outcomes have resurrected endodontics' biggest problem, lack of adequate recall rates. Private practice recall rates are so poor that almost no scientific data can be gleaned from them. Some clinicians say, well, I've been an endodontist for a number of years and this is my experience. Those impressions, while they may be very well-intended, carry little scientific value according to those who do such studies professionally. And we are about science, aren't we? I vividly recall an AAE in Dallas many years ago when I asked a distinguished and famous Scandinavian academic, how can we span the gulf between the perceptions of private practice clinical experience with the requirements of proper scientific study? How can private practicing clinicians contribute? His answer was, they can't. For the studies to be meaningful and the conclusions to be valid, not only must the studies be meticulously designed and controlled, but they must also rely heavily on recall data that simply is impractical to obtain in the average private practice setting. Are there exceptions? Certainly. My friend Dr. Terry Pancook's private practice CBCT study of sequential cases presented at the AAE meeting a few years ago is probably as close as anybody can come to this ideal. But look at the huge effort and the cost that's required. Let's do some math and see if it's practical for the average endodontist who has practiced 25 years working 220 days per year with an average of 3 working cases completed in an 8-hour day. Therefore, in an entire year, let's say you finish 660 cases in a year. If you're going to multi-step cases, multi-treatment appointments, that's not unrealistic. If you do single appointment treatment, your completed case number may be as much as twice that number, or maybe even more. Over 25 years, that's roughly 16,500 cases. So let's round down a bit, maybe to 14,500, because you're meticulous. If you do single appointment treatment, your recall requirement number will be much, much higher because you've done so many more cases. So let's assume a recall rate of about 20%. Dr. Fred Barnett's AAE lecture in 2017 stated that the university recall rates in the best published studies were between 25 and 27% in what is essentially a captive patient pool. 20% recall is pretty crappy as recalls go, but it's optimistic for many private practice endodontic offices, especially when patients are asymptomatic after treatment or you have an aging patient base. By the way, a 20% recall rate would be laughed out of any serious medical study. So that means maybe 2,900 cases a year that you have to recall. That's for annual recalls. By that, I mean many of our recall cases may be 6-month recalls, shorter time soft tissue checks, calcium hydroxide medication and apexification checks, and others that have greater frequency than once per year. So let's say after all that practice time, you have 3,000 cases a year that need to be recalled out of all the cases you've done in your entire career. At a lousy 20% recall rate, how do you do this? Well, assuming that you have a two-chair practice and a CBCT consult room, and your practice style involves, number one, you don't interrupt your treatment once you start working on a case. In other words, you don't bounce from room to room. Number two, you perform comprehensive examinations, not a single tooth, quick discussion, 5-second in and out. You take images, you don't rush the consult, you spend maybe 15 minutes, I don't know, pick a reasonable number, getting to know the patient, discussing and explaining things like missed anatomy, reviewing imaging, explaining previous failing treatment, explaining treatment options and the reasons for the need for retreatment, prognosis, discussing post-operative restoration, implant options and fees, as well as everything that's involved with informed consent. Never mind the extra time that's required for CBCT reviews. And number three, your recall examination consists of a PA and a bite wing, a perio evaluation, palpation, percussion, chewing tests, evaluation of the restoration placed over your endo, the occlusion, and any other features pertinent to the case. So let's say maybe 5 minutes tops on an asymptomatic case. That doesn't even consider the discussions that need to take place when facing a recall of one of your failed cases and how you need to address the logistics of retreatment, treatment options such as surgery, extraction, and implant placement, and how you will deal with any fees involved considering the fact the patient's already paid for the initial treatment. So how do you work in 3,000 recall cases in a 220-day working day year? Well, that's 13 recalls a day at a poor 20% recall rate. Sure, there may be patients that have multiple teeth that can be recalled while you're working or recalling other teeth. Let's factor that into the equation and let's reduce the recalls to, let's say, 10 recalls a day. So you're doing 10 recalls in a day on average. Assuming that it takes your staff at least 5 minutes to break down and sterilize and seat the patient, that means almost 1 hour of your staff time is taken up simply preparing one operatory for what amounts to confirmation that your treatment was or remained successful. Then you spend almost 1 hour per day doing just recalls, all this for zero practice production at your cost. And we wonder why endo recall rates are so poor. So where does that leave us? The school university-based studies are criticized by experienced clinicians saying, well, the recall rates may be better than in my clinic because of the tighter patient control, but the skill level of the grad or postdoc students is far below mine. I'm an experienced endodontist with many years of clinical practice. I'll have better success. The academics look at the private practitioner's claim and say, well, your clinical impressions are meaningless. They're not science. Without proper recall rates, controls, and study protocols, you can't say that. Their intuitions are the lowest level of evidence and have very little, if any, scientific value. What you think or feel about your practice success rates is unsupported by real scientific data. Until endodontics can design proper studies, which will likely take much more money than we will ever be able to raise, these arguments such as 1 versus 2 appointment, calcium hydroxide or not, bigger or smaller canal shapes, bigger or small access openings, this technique versus that technique, this irrigation protocol versus this device, and all the other things that we argue about will still persist. Look at the millions of dollars that are required to just have one medical drug approved. The truth is, for most practitioners, they perform endodontics for a living, not as a hobby. The moment that our fee or recall rates begin to encroach on our ability to make a living, we know what's going to happen. We will only recall cases that are symptomatic or that are failing, as many of us do now. Furthermore, patients tend to not to seek us out when they're asymptomatic. It's not sore, you're not gonna go to the dentist if you don't have to. Referring dentists rarely perform routine proper recalls, the kind of recall examinations that we do on our treated cases. They didn't do the treatment and some regard it as a waste of their time. I will occasionally get a periapical radiograph from a referral, but that's infrequent. And these radiographs are often so poorly done that they're not of diagnostic quality. Mostly you get films when your case is failing and hardly ever when it's successful. Failing teeth are often extracted without our knowledge, further contributing to our positive good feeling bias and the possible misinterpretation of our success rates. Few of us really know what our success rates may truly be. Are we willing to pay the patients to come in for recalls? Perhaps that's the only way we can get a decent recall rate. I submit to you that most clinicians are not willing to do that simply to satisfy their curiosity. And those that do can do so because they don't need the money. The controversy continues. Remember, when we do the right thing, we both get better, clinicians and patients. Thanks for listening to me here on Beyond the Terminus, and I look forward to seeing you next time.